Harper Business and Harper Audio present Yellen, the Trailblazing Economist Who Navigated an Era of Upheaval by Jon Hilsenrath, read by Seth Podowitz. Dedication read by Jon Hilsenrath. A note before we begin. For notes on the text, a bibliography, and the author's acknowledgments, don't forget to download the accompanying enhancement PDF from your audiobook provider or go directly to harpercollins.com/pages/Yellen.
From my mother, Elaine, who taught me to think critically and that history turns like a kaleidoscope. And from my father, Joseph, who taught me to embrace every day with hope and purpose and to love the meanings, sounds, and rhythms of words.
Introduction. Janet Yellen followed her routine on the way to Washington, D.C. She packed her bags carefully and arrived at the San Francisco airport early. She didn't like mishaps, and she wasn't one to hurry while traveling, so she always left hours in advance to be the first person at the gate. There she sat, waiting for her long-haul flight to the East Coast while thumbing through briefing books prepared by her staff and playing Brick Breaker on her phone. Yellen was a worrier, and she moved methodically. Her approach to life was to plan and prepare for all contingencies. For a woman making her way in a man's business, preparation was especially important. She worked details over in her head, reading up, thinking through scenarios, calculating probabilities for different outcomes, and sizing up strategies for how to respond should worst-case scenarios become actual problems. She had picked up an exacting attention to detail from her mother, Ruth. When Yellen was a girl growing up in Brooklyn in the 1950s, Ruth often sent Yellen's older brother, John, down the street to fetch the day's newspaper. Then the children watched their mother sit with the paper, in a dress with her feet up on a couch, meticulously writing down daily stock prices she tracked on the back of envelopes in neat square handwriting. "Do your homework," Yellen learned. "Don't be caught off guard by outcomes you could have foreseen. Eliminate worries, reduce unnecessary risk. Prepare." In December 2009, the United States was emerging from more than 2 years of shocking financial crisis. The economy was growing again. Janet Yellen, however, still had a great many worries. Yellen was a central banker, 63 years old, one of 12 presidents of Federal Reserve banks spread around the country, two of which were run by women. Their job was to monitor the economy and the banking system, look out for problems like inflation or banks struggling with bad loans, and then work with the powerful Federal Reserve Board in Washington to figure out how to respond. When banks were failing, the Fed was called in to help sort their problems out. When the economy careened toward recession, the Fed had to rescue it. The San Francisco Fed, which Yellen ran, was mandated to monitor a vast piece of the U.S. economy covering 1.4 million square miles, from frigid mountain peaks in northern Oregon to dusty Native American tribal lands in the Arizona desert. In between were the nation's hotbed tech market in Silicon Valley, and pockets of some of its most unstable real estate markets, including Los Angeles, Las Vegas, and Phoenix. In all, it had a greater land mass than India and was home to 69 million people and 31 million workers, about a fifth of the nation's population and a large part of the national economy. During the preceding 2 years, a succession of big financial institutions had teetered or collapsed. Their top executives, typically the most confident of men, spent long weekends begging competitors and the Fed to save them during fraught rescue negotiations as frightened investors and depositors in their institutions fled for safety from the storm. The list of casualties was long, diverse, and astonishing. Countrywide Financial, Bear Stearns, Fannie Mae, Lehman Brothers, Merrill Lynch, American International Group, AIG, Citigroup, General Electric, and many others. Their problem was a mortgage meltdown. Americans had binged on mortgage debt in an era of low interest rates and financial innovation. They took out loans with unusual terms and used the cash to bid up the prices of homes, to pay for vacations and cars, or simply to cover their regular bills. Wall Street encouraged the frenzy, buying many of these mortgages and selling them to investors around the world in complicated financial packages. For a while, this boosted profits and executive pay. Then, overburdened households delayed or defaulted on debts. When mortgage delinquencies piled up, the financial system was starved of funds and nearly collapsed. Some of the most aggressive mortgage writing happened in the West, which Yellen was monitoring. That meant she saw problems brewing early, though not early enough nor with the authority in a diffuse regulatory system to stop it. As mortgages went bad, lenders panicked for funds, which in turn set off a frenzy inside the Fed to stop a potentially catastrophic crisis. The Fed's healing medicine was money. It provided loans to banks when funds were nowhere else to be found. It tried to work in an orderly manner. In this case, it administered its medicine as slews of patients crashed at its doors, convulsing and near death. Yellen foresaw the panic before many of her colleagues at the Fed and urged them to move swiftly to stamp it out. The Fed's responses prevented a financial collapse, but the nation was still left with something terrible. After 2 years of exhausting bank rescues, a recession had cascaded out of the canyons of Wall Street to communities across America, leaving more than 15 million people unemployed. In December 2009, Yellen didn't think jobs would be coming back anytime soon. As she saw it, this was the next crisis. It all seemed so unfair. Wall Street got bailouts, and for good reason. The crisis revealed that the economy couldn't work if banks stopped making loans. But while the banks got support, millions of Americans were left behind to pick up the pieces of their lives with part-time jobs, food stamps, and disability claims. Two Princeton professors would later use the term deaths of despair to describe lives lost to depression, drug addiction, alcoholism, and suicide. A long-running trend that further signaled a nation where elites and everyone else were on two different tracks. After landing in Washington, D.C. that December evening, Yellen gathered with the 11 other regional bank presidents for an informal dinner in a hotel a few blocks from the Fed's austere Depression-era building on Constitution Avenue. The next day, the regional bank presidents met formally with five Washington-based Fed board governors and an army of PhD-trained staff to discuss the grim economic outlook and what to do about it. Technically, economic output was growing again, which meant a recovery had started, yet the unemployment rate had recently risen to 10%. They sat in a cavernous boardroom with two-story-high ceilings, its tall windows decorated with elegant light drapes. Above the large mahogany table at its center hung a dark, pointed chandelier that hovered above their heads like the tip of a missile that had crashed through the building, poised to detonate. Yellen, who stood around 5 feet tall, wore modest dark pantsuits to meetings, sometimes dressed up with a silk scarf. Ben Bernanke, an introverted and socially awkward genius who had written books on the Great Depression, conducted the proceedings as the Fed's chairman. As a young academic, Bernanke had concluded that the Fed's hesitation to act had made the Great Depression much worse than it needed to be. He was a quiet man with bold views and the burden of orchestrating the Fed's response. Bernanke had been in the job less than 4 years, having taken over from Alan Greenspan, a legendary central banker who led the institution through nearly two decades of rising prosperity, and then retired just before the cracks in the economy were becoming apparent. Fed staff sat along walls in a periphery of stiff chairs around the boardroom table, deciphering results from computer models they used to track the economy and predict where it would go next. One model had its own odd-sounding name, FRBUS, for FRB/US. This model had been created in the 1990s with great ambition and internal fanfare to simulate how the economy would behave under different scenarios. Punch in an oil price jump, and Furbus would estimate how much less consumers hit by higher gasoline costs would spend, say, on cars or restaurant meals. Punch in a stock price boom, and Furbus would say how many jobs would be created. There was one big problem with Furbus, though. Nobody had thought to program it to calculate the effect on the economy if the entire financial system almost collapsed. Bernanke turned to Yellen when it was time for the regional bank presidents to share their views about what they were seeing back home. The bailouts were over, and officials believed a recovery had started, but Yellen warned that it didn't actually feel like one. She pulled out a prepared statement and read it carefully, sticking to her script. Business executives she knew in the West, shell-shocked and traumatized from recent events, continued to lay people off. Because they had little confidence about the outlook, they still weren't considering investing or hiring. She said, they remain focused on ensuring their survival. Fed officials were exhausted and uncertain after 2 years of crisis fighting. During recessions, the central bank pumped money into the financial system, which helped to lower interest rates. Those lower borrowing costs in turn spurred the economy by helping businesses and households to refinance loans or take out new loans to invest and spend. But the Fed had already pushed its benchmark interest rate to near zero. How could it go any lower? What else could it do to help the damaged economy? It experimented with other strategies, including a program to buy mortgage bonds and U.S. government bonds in an effort to bring down an even wider array of interest rates. But the costs and benefits of that unusual therapy were unknown, and many Fed officials wanted to stop before the central bank caused some new problem. Yellen was restrained, courteous, and deliberate in these formal meetings, but her message to her colleagues was forceful. Their work wasn't done. I continue to see a persuasive case for further policy easing, she told them. Back in San Francisco, her colleagues were seeing an even bolder Janet Yellen emerge, animated and urgent about confronting an economic crisis that she was sure wasn't close to being over. These are fucking people! She exclaimed during a San Francisco staff briefing about the jobs problem, pounding the table with her fist. She didn't want the economists reporting to her to look at the high unemployment rates they were projecting as just a bunch of statistics. The human suffering that persisted after the financial crisis was enormous, and they needed to work at that problem with the same sense of purpose and urgency that they had brought to repairing banks. It was in these moments, after the fires of financial crisis had been extinguished and the enormity of rebuilding a damaged economy had sunk in, that Janet Yellen emerged as the most powerful woman in American economic history. She was 2 years away from the normal retirement age, and her most important and complex years of work still lay ahead of her. Yellen had already served as the chair of the White House Council of Economic Advisors for President Bill Clinton in the late 1990s. In that role, she was a top economic advisor to the president in a rough-and-tumble White House. In 2009, she wasn't yet aware that she was on course to become chair of the Federal Reserve, the nation's central bank, charged with managing interest rates, containing inflation, and stamping out financial panics. Then she would become Secretary of the Treasury, charged with overseeing the tax system, the federal government's debt, and sanctions programs aimed at adversaries abroad. No person in American history to that point had ever had all three of these jobs. Yellen held each in a period of confounding and unprecedented economic upheaval. The nation's elites, its political leaders, business titans, and esteemed academics had begun the new millennium thinking they were marching into a new era of global prosperity, driven by advancing technology, widening international trade, Wall Street savvy, and wise central banking. In the year 2000, they had projected budget surpluses, rising incomes, and a new economy charged up by life-changing technology. This new era also seemed to promise peace and freedom, Soviet rule over Russia and Eastern Europe had ended. China was coming on the scene. They thought that would be good too. But something else happened. By 2009, the United States was already several years into a period of stagnating household incomes, slowing job growth, rising inequality, and waning economic mobility. A bursting stock bubble, then terror attacks, war in Afghanistan and Iraq, and the emergence of China as a global trade leviathan had already thrown the United States off course. The financial shock meant the worst of a tectonic shift in the American economic landscape was yet to come. Shockwaves unleashed by trade, technology, high finance, and an aging population.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.